At absolute zero temperature, a subsystem can behave as hot because of quantum correlations with the rest of the system. That is because of entanglement. And here, what I'm thinking about is an isolated quantum system consisting of two parts. It's in an energy eigen state. It's cold. It's at zero temperature. And you make measurements only on the part A, and you find this thermal behavior. You find that it's hot. I'd like to give two examples. One comes from condensed matter, cold atoms in optical lattices, where the isolated quantum system is in an energy eigen state of this, of the many-body Hamiltonian, and the subsystem is just few atoms. And you find a thermal behavior for these few atoms. And this fact has apparently been rediscovered many times and appears under different names as eigenstate thermalization, canonical typicality, or the name that I prefer, entanglement thermodynamics. The second example is about quantum field theory in flat space. You consider the Minkowski vacuum state, the state at zero temperature, and it turns out that when you focus on the subsystem, on an accelerated thermometer, you find it measures a temperature, a finite temperature, the Unruh temperature. And this is the thermality of the Rindler wedge that is due to vacuum entanglement, quantum correlations at space-like separations. And in this talk, I would like to tell you about something that I think is a third example. So let me move to the puzzle, the topic of this plenary session, that is, what is the nature of black hole entropy? As we know, as we have heard from Alejandro, black holes are thermal objects. They emit thermal radiation, they have thermal properties, they have an entropy, as Bekenstein and Hawking told us. If you drop something into a black hole, its mass is going to increase, its area is going to increase, and the entropy increases accordingly in a way that is proportional to the area. And the question is, what is the nature of this entropy? Is the system like a gas in a box, where you have to count states and compute the entropy statistics in a way that is like in statistical mechanics, or it has a different nature? And what I would like to argue is that this system is like the systems that I was describing before. In particular, it is in a definite state, and the entropy is coming from entanglement. The thermal properties are coming from entanglement. The idea that the reason for having black hole entropy is because of entanglement is an old idea. That's a long story. There have been many developments. Here, what I would like to present is one specific realization that is, in particular, the one that I'm giving here, a perturbative realization, perturbative for small perturbations, where one can show that this small perturbation leads to a variation of the entanglement entropy that is small and satisfies the Bekenstein-Hawking area law. And this perturbative realization, in fact, comes from a first realization that was found, that I found in spin phones, and then turned out to be robust and universal, and also perturbatively in perturbative quantum field theory. And as I said, this idea comes really from spin phones and from a number of developments. It has been an exciting time in the last 2 years. There have been plenty of developments in loop quantum gravity and spin phones related to black hole entropy. And in particular, I want to mention a few that I'm going to use. The first one in particular that Alejandro has beautifully described, that is the relevance of near horizon physics and the first law, the near horizon first law, or if you want, the mechanical laws of the Rindler horizon. So let's start. That's the plan of my talk. I'll briefly tell you again why near horizon physics, then move to entanglement and quantum fluctuations. So I'm thinking about a black hole, a big black hole like the one at the center of our galaxy. For this black hole, the curvature of the horizon is smaller. In fact, the horizon radius is a few percent distance from the Earth to the Sun, and the curvature at the horizon is not so different from the curvature here in this room. And in particular, if instead of looking at what happens when you let something fall in from infinity, you shift the focus to an observer that is stationary and close to the horizon, the family of observers that we heard about before. For instance, you have a spaceship at fixed distance from the horizon, and we drop something in. As the curvature is smaller, in a small patch, we can approximate everything with flat space physics. The trajectory is a Rindrach trajectory at a uniform acceleration that is proportional to 1 over the proper distance from the horizon. And what I'll do in the following is focus on this small region, near horizon region, and describe the physics there. And I'll start with a description that is in perturbative quantum field theory, in perturbative quantum gravity, because in this regime, we do not expect big quantum gravity effects, big genuine quantum gravity effects. And then I'll move to spin forms. So in the following, I'll speak about Minkowski, and that's the reason I'm focusing on this small region. In particular, I'll speak about entanglement thermodynamics in Minkowski. So entanglement, I should first tell you briefly about the standard notions of about bipartite quantum systems, like the ones I described before, when a Hilbert space is tensor product of a part A and a part B. And I'll concentrate on observables, a subalgebra of observables that acts non-trivially only on B. And when you're given a state and you are allowed to probe it only measuring observables in B, you find that all the quantum uncertainties in the states are completely described by a reduced density matrix. And now that you have the reduced density matrix, you can compute the statistical entropy for this density matrix. And this is the entanglement entropy. And the standard example is the EPR pair, a scalar particle that decays in 2 particles of spin 1/2. If you are allowed to measure only one of the 2 particles, you are not going to be able to tell anything about the direction of the spin of this particle. In particular, you will be in a completely mixed state with entropy, entanglement entropy, logarithm of 2. And the reason is that its density matrix is completely mixed. This subsystem was at a very large temperature compared to the separation of the 2 levels at infinite temperature. And it turns out that quantum field theory is, in a very natural way, a bipartite quantum system. When you look at regions of space-time, for instance, at t equals 0, you can consider x less than 0 and x positive, or covariantly, in a space-time picture, the left and the right Rindler wedge. And these are causally disconnected. And the Minkowski vacuum, this state of absolute zero temperature, happens to have a very specific amount of entanglement between modes on the left and on the right. It's a very ordered state. And this very ordered state has this amount of entanglement that corresponds to the statement that there are correlations at space-like separation that you can read from the two-point function. Now, the idea is that I'm choosing a set of observables supported in one wedge, in the right Rindler wedge. So the relevant quantity is the reduced density matrix that happens to be thermal at a universal temperature. That's the thermality of the Rindler wedge. And now you can compute the entanglement entropy of this reduced density matrix. And as is well known, this is divergent. It diverges quadratically with a UV cutoff and scales as the area of the entangling surface, the separating surface. So it depends on the regularization. And if you have a good reason to put the cutoff at the Planck scale, you may argue that this, in fact, explains black hole entropy, because you would find an entropy that scales as area over Planck square. However, to make this idea precise and work, you have to address a number of difficulties. In particular, if you put a cutoff at the Planck scale, you would have the problem that EI is area of your cutoff square, But the Bekenstein Hawking entropy doesn't contain the Planck scale in the UV. It contains G Newton in the infrared, the one that you measure with Kepler law, looking at elliptic orbits, planets. Also, this is the entropy of one matter field, but we have a few, and this entropy is addictive. You would have, if you have seven matter fields, 7C0. That's the species problem. And moreover, you don't see any hint of universality of why the one quarter should arise. Now, I'm not saying that there are in fact many ideas how to make this work, but it's clear that you need a non-perturbative theory of quantum gravity, a theory that holds at this scale, a theory like spin forms. So what I'll do first, as my motivation was perturbative in Minkowski space, is investigate a situation where the entanglement entropy is under control because I'm only looking at low energy phenomena. And I'm doing this in this way. Instead of looking at the entanglement entropy of the vacuum alone, I'm going to perturb the vacuum. I'm going to consider a second state, a small perturbation of the vacuum, compute its entanglement entropy, and compare it to the one of the vacuum. As we always do in quantum field theory, that we compare quantities to the expectation value of the vacuum, for instance, the energy momentum tensor. So I'll consider a small perturbation of the vacuum, compute its entanglement entropy, in particular the difference between its entanglement entropy and the one of the vacuum, the delta S entanglement. And I want to discuss three results about this quantity. The first result is that while the entanglement entropy of this excited state is divergent, like the one of the vacuum, the variation, the difference, is finite. It's finite because the divergences are in the ultraviolet and are universal. The perturbation is in infrared and doesn't change them. So the divergences cancel. And now that you have a finite quantity, you have to ask, what is the physical interpretation of this quantity? And it turns out it has a very clear physical interpretation. It has a thermodynamic interpretation. It is given by the energy flux, the amount of energy that crosses the Rindler horizon that is present when you split Minkowski space in two, divided by a temperature that is the Unruh temperature. So this quantity has a thermodynamic interpretation. It satisfies a first law, a Clausius relation. And up to this point, gravity is frozen. I'm just speaking about quantum fields in Minkowski space. But what if we unfreeze gravity? And in this case, we know how to do it at the quantum level. We know how to do quantum gravity in this situation because the perturbation is low energy. This law holds for small low energy perturbations. So we know how to treat the gravitational back reaction perturbatively in perturbative quantum gravity. And when you do this, you find that as gravity couples universally to everything, this perturbation in the entanglement entropy turns out to be universal and equal to the change in area of your horizon that is now dynamical, divided by 4G. With G now the low energy one, the infrared one, because we only looked at low energy phenomena. Okay, so I want to discuss in some more detail these three points, providing examples and explaining them in more detail. I'll speed up a bit. Let me start with the first. So what I want to present is an example of how this delta S entanglement is finite. It's a recent calculation that we did with Catania'nu and Mercati. We considered a one particle state in Minkowski for a two-dimensional pre-massless scalar. And this one particle state is in one Unruh mode of frequency omega. And in this case, we can compute the entanglement entropy analytically for this state one. Likewise for zero, putting a cutoff, and take the difference. And the difference can be given analytically by this complicated formula that you can just plot. And that's the value, it's finite. I'll skip the second example, and I'll move to the thermodynamic relation. Why does this hold, and how? And when is, what is the regime of validity? So to do this, I have to introduce some basic notions that are relevant for the thermodynamics of entanglement. First of all, I'm speaking about quantum field theory in Minkowski space. There's a symmetry Lorentz invariance. There are Noether charges. In particular, there's the major current for bus, and it's charged that it's the generator of bus that I will use in the following. KR, the part restricted on in the right Findler wedge. Then when you consider one of these accelerated observers with acceleration A, you find that the energy that she measures is the Rindler energy that turns out to be proportional to the generator of boost times the acceleration. Third quantity that I need is the energy crossing the Rindler horizon. Rindler horizon is the boundary of the past of the trajectory here in blue of the Rindler observer. So how much energy crosses this horizon? Well, it's some function of the energy momentum tensor integrated over the horizon. It depends on A because A, this observer is the one that measures this energy flux. And all these quantities express T in terms of the energy momentum tensor, so you can understand them both at the classical level or at the quantum level in perturbative quantum field theory. And in particular, as the current is conserved, the sum of the three is zero, and if you assume, and it's a very mild assumption, that no energy leaks to infinity, then the Rindler energy equals the energy that crosses the Rindler horizon. Okay, now that I have all the tools, I move to the thermodynamic relation. As I already mentioned before, the reduced density matrix for the vacuum is thermal, is a Gibbs state for the Hamiltonian that is the boost Hamiltonian at a universal geometric temperature 1 over 2 pi. The small perturbation, I can compute the reduced density matrix for the small perturbation, can compute the energy crossing the horizon, and now I'm ready to compute the variation of the entanglement entropy, simply deriving the definition of the entanglement entropy. So in a few steps, first derive rho, and then log rho. Second part vanishes because the trace of the delta rho is zero, is one minus one. Then the first part is logarithm of rho zero, that brings the boost down. There's a 2 pi trace k delta rho. And now you recognize the energy flux through the Rindler horizon. Here it is. And you recognize the Unruh temperature. It gives you the flux, the energy crossing the Rindler horizon, measured by this observer, divided by the temperature that this observer measures, equals the change in entanglement entropy. And the clear assumption is that the perturbation is smaller. We're going not too far from equilibrium. If you look at this derivation, you'll probably notice that it's the familiar one. It's the one that you can find in statistical mechanics books, where the Clausius relation is derived in statistical mechanics. And here, the new thing is that we're deriving it from entanglement. So just one step up. We are seeing where this rho is coming from. So again, the same spirit, I give an example of when this happens. And the example really comes from a situation worked out by Unruh and Wald, where they study a two-level atom coupled to a field. The two-level atom is accelerated. It starts in the excited state, and then as it evolves, coupling to a field, it generates entanglement between the atom and the field. So at first order, the perturbation theory is given by this superposition, this entangled state, field in the vacuum, atom excited, plus coupling constant that is small, field excited, atom in the vacuum. So now you have two states. The first one is essentially the vacuum, and it's non-entangled with the atom. It's the vacuum for your quantum field. So that's my S0, my entropy of the vacuum. And the second one is this perturbation. It is small because the coupling constant can be tuned to be small. So I can compute the density matrix where I trace away both the atom and the field on the left. And what I end up is with this density matrix, I can compute the energy, some simple function. I can compute the change, the finite difference in entanglement entropy, some quite complicated function. It's better just to plot them. And you see that they agree very well in the regime where they are expected to agree. It is when the perturbation from thermal equilibrium is smaller. It is in this regime. Okay, very good. So thermodynamics of entanglement, and up to this point there's no gravity yet, and now gravity comes in perturbatively, as I told you a moment ago. Perturbatively, that means I'm going to consider the metric as a small perturbation on the flat metric, and I'm considering the perturbation as a field, a quantum field, the gravitational field. And as you know, it's going to satisfy equations of motion that are the perturbative version of Einstein equations. Okay, so I'm going to use these equations of motion in a moment. Now, what is the Rindler horizon when gravity switched on? So let's start first looking at light rays that span the Rindler horizon. I'm putting here the initial condition, that is it's light rays pointing in this direction and collimated, and they remain collimated if they don't interact with gravity, if gravity is switched off. But now I'm switching gravity on, and in particular, as if there's some energy crossing this beam of light, this is going to focus light rays because gravity is attractive, it focuses even light, and it's going to collimate them. And you can compute how they are collimated just looking at the solutions of just the classical solutions of the geodesics, if you want. But now these light rays don't belong anymore to the horizon. The ones that belong to the horizon are the ones that are finely tuned between falling out of sight and reaching infinity. So in particular, they have to start divergent so that they are collimated by energy crossing the light rays. Collimated and arrive collimated at infinity. So if you want, given some energy that is going to go through, what I have to do is to put in front of my flashlight a diverging lens. And I have to adjust the diverging lens in a way that depends on the energy that is going to cross the horizon. That's the nature of the horizon. It's like the hottest day in summer. You have to wait the end of summer to know which one is it. And in particular, now everything is written in terms of h mu nu, my gravitational field. It is quantum. And I can compute the area of the horizon. And the area of the horizon is given by this formula. It is a classical formula, but it's also a quantum formula in way perturbative quantum theory. So I have an operator, the area operator for the horizon in perturbative quantum gravity. Now I'm going to use it. So how? Small perturbation as before. I look again at the variation of the entanglement entropy exactly as before. We find that it's 2 pi 3 k delta rho. That's the energy conservation. That's the Clausius relation, if you want. And now what I'm going to do is to write it in terms of the energy momentum tensor under the assumption that no energy leaks to infinity. And if I use the equations of motion, I can write the energy momentum tensor in terms of a gravitational back reaction, is box h mu nu. And now you recognize the area operator. This is the difference in expectation value, so the area operator on the perturbed state, on the excited state, minus the expectation value of the vacuum. The 2 pi cancels the 8 pi, and you get delta area of the horizon divided by 4g, where now g is the low energy one, and this is the Bekenstein-Hawking entropy, area law, for entanglement. And the surprising thing is that this is derived in a completely perturbative way, identifying the regime where you can do that. And it is surprising because, in a sense, it is always stated that this should be an ultraviolet phenomenon, a phenomenon that, to derive it microscopically, you need to have a full theory of quantum gravity. Yeah, what I've identified is a situation where everything is under control, it's perturbative, and you understand how it happens, how the result is universal. It's universal and independent of the number of matter fields and the kinds, the species, because gravity is coupling universally to the energy momentum tensor. There's no ultraviolet contribution because they cancel in the difference. You have to have a good reason to put an ultraviolet cutoff. You need to have a theory of quantum gravity if you want to motivate it. But here I'm simply putting the cutoff, taking the difference, and showing that the difference doesn't depend on the cutoff. And that's the thing I was mentioning in the very beginning. This calculation was done first in spin forms, but you don't have any divergences, and you take differences. And surprisingly, you find that the dependence on the details of the theory just drop out. The value of the Mirzi parameter in particular doesn't appear in the difference. And the last remark is low energy G. Okay, so all this is for perturbative quantum gravity. Now, what about spin forms? Well, Mushin and Frank, in their talks, we're gonna tell you in detail about spin forms. It's the path integral for four-dimensional Lorentzian geometries with gravitational degrees of freedom that are unfrozen only on a two-dimensional form. And when you do this, you get a covariant formulation of loop quantum gravity. And the key thing in this formulation is that you have a spin form representation in terms of invariance of the Lorentz group. And what appears in this invariance is some special representations, gamma simple representations. And that's the technical thing, the key feature that is going to play a role in a moment. So what's the difference between perturbative and non-perturbative already at the classical level? At the classical level, you can consider a partial Cauchy slice and evolve it, consider its Cauchy development and evolve it keeping this S fixed. And what happens is that once you give data on this Cauchy slice, you know everything about the evolution in this wedge. Non-perturbative general relativity is like a good meteorologist. Once you know everything about your Cauchy data, you're going to tell everything about the horizon in its area. And now there are two key features. The general relativity action vanishes in the bulk. And there's a corner term that is, in fact, a boost term. When you write it in spin form variables in this gamma BF topological theory with constraints on the two form, you find that this boundary term, this corner term here, is the generator of boosts. That on these representations that unfreeze degrees of freedom is gamma times L, that already at the classical level has the interpretation of area of 8 pi g, and at the quantum level, just the same. And this is something that was in fact first noticed by Carlip and Teitelboim in metric variables when they described the Schrödinger equations for the horizon. So this is going to play a role in a moment. So what I'm going to do is to compute entanglement for a spin network state. And it's particularly simple if I consider a spin network state with spins that are fixed, but intertwiners that are in a superposition. In that case, the Hilbert space is a product over nodes, intertwiners at nodes. And in a natural sense, it's a tensor product, nodes inside, nodes outside, considering a region A. And a state is a state of this form. It has no entanglement if these coefficients are a product, if there's no entanglement between intertwiners. Otherwise, there is entanglement. How do you compute it? How do you measure it? Entanglement entropy. And this quantity that was already considered by Donnelly plays a crucial role now because given a spin network state, you can have that there is entanglement or not. Depends on the state. But now, what kind of states does spin form give us? Once we have spin forms, so we have a dynamics that we can use either like Hartle and Hawking did to produce a state, an Hartle-Hawking state, or more simply, we can mimic exactly what I described from Minkowski space, that is introducing correlations that correspond to the e to the minus pi k, it is the analogous of the correlations in Minkowski space. Yeah, we have k, it's this Hermitian operator on our representations, the irreducible representations of the Lorentz group that play a crucial role. So if you want this state, the Hartle-Hawking spin network state, is the one that you obtain with Euclidean spin form at one step, just one bubble. And it has a key property that is when you write it in this representation in terms of intertwiners, these psi coefficients entangled. In fact, this at this level of one step in the Patti integral, this is a tensor product state of the kind that is studied in condensed matter. Yeah, it's the simplest kind of entanglement that you can have in these situations. And now we can compute the entanglement entry with this state. So what I'm saying is, there is one state. It's coming from spin forms. I just compute its entanglement entropy. That's all I'm doing. And there's something interesting that happens. Two contributions. The second one comes from log from Z, from the normalization. The first one, as always, comes from the logarithm of rho, that is e to the minus pi k e to the minus pi k. It gives a 2 pi k. The first term as our states are in the physical Hilbert space, in the Hilbert space of spin forms, where there's a relation between k and L, k equal gamma L. This becomes sum of L with a gamma going outside. Focus on the first term. This is the area in loop quantum gravity divided by 8 pi g h bar gamma. That's the way gamma appears every time when you do statistical mechanics counting with areas. There's a gamma outside here that cancels this gamma. So you get area over 4 g h bar. That's the first term. But careful, this g is the ultraviolet one. So there's a first surprising thing that is we are getting a term that is the Bekenstein-Hawking entropy in the ultraviolet. And this is the one. This formula is really the same that Alejandro Perez was discussing, starting from a very different point. So I think my understanding at the moment is that this formula can be read in this way. If you are in the ultraviolet and you consider a perturbation of your state that doesn't change the graph, doesn't go out of this Hilbert space, this is just a constant. And in the variation, you get a Bekenstein-Hawking area low in the ultraviolet. This is not the black hole one. This is not the low energy one. This is something new. Then you can do something else. You can look at perturbations in the infrared. And in the infrared, if you obtain only this term, that would be the wrong answer, because it would have the ultraviolet G Newton. We want the infrared G Newton. So there's a physical question here. If the two together at low energies give the infrared G Newton, and Alejandro has discussed during his talk a very specific realization of this idea. So that's the status as I understand it at the moment in spin forms. Okay, so last 5 minutes I would like to comment on quantum fluctuations and statistical fluctuations, and what is the meaning of this calculation that I've presented. As you know, when one counts states, as we do in loop quantum gravity, counting states assumes that the black hole is in a statistical ensemble. And these statistical fluctuations, you can understand them as fluctuations of the shape of the horizon. So the first question is, why it's in this statistical ensemble? What thermalizes the black hole? And at what temperature? And the second question is something that comes from a beautiful paper by Lee from 85, where he asks, can we distinguish statistical fluctuations from quantum fluctuations for a black hole? And what I would like to argue is that entanglement across the horizon results in a thermal ensemble for the shapes of the horizon when you measure only observables outside. In fact, we saw that. In fact, this happens already perturbatively. And so if you just focus on doing the statistical mechanics and studying the thermal ensemble, you're going to recover all the properties that this system has. The only thing that you don't have looking at the system in this way is what is its temperature. This has to be an external input, as we saw in the previous talk. So what entanglement is doing for you is to give you a universal temperature, give you the reason why the system appears to be hot. The system is in a pure state, but you're observing only a subsystem. And this idea that there are statistical fluctuations and quantum fluctuations and the statistical fluctuations in the area can be understood as quantum fluctuations is something that one can investigate already perturbatively. So I would like to mention it briefly. It's something new that is going to appear soon. And I like to call the evaporation of the Rindler horizon. Evaporation, the Rindler horizon is at equilibrium, so it cannot evaporate. Unless you couple it to something colder. For instance, if you couple it to a two-level atom, in its ground state, this is colder. You could put many. Let's put just one for the moment. And I'm going back again to the framework that was introduced by Unruh and Ward and studied by them. What I'm going to do now is to look at not just at the field, how the atom gets entangled with the field, but as we have understood that the area of the horizon, the perturbative quantum field theory, Rindler horizon, is dynamical, it's an operator, I can equally phrase it in terms of entanglement between my atom and the area of the horizon. So if the atom is initially in the ground state and the field is in the vacuum, this corresponds to the horizon having given fixed area that remains the same. But as there is interaction between the two systems that are initially not entangled become entangled perturbatively at first order in perturbation theory. So the state becomes a superposition of this first state that I just described and a second state where the atom goes from the ground state to the excited state, and correspondingly, the field is excited. It corresponds to a negative energy flux through the horizon that, in terms of the area, corresponds to smaller area for the horizon. So what you have is a superposition of these two states, superposition of different areas, and now suppose that you don't observe the atom. You trace over the atom. What you get is a thermal ensemble for the area, or if you want, for the shape of the horizon. So I would like to conclude here with a picture. The question that we have been asking is, why are black holes hot? Are they like a gas in a box? Something that I should count states? What is boiling? Why they are hot? What is boiling at the surface of the horizon? And what I've been arguing is that they are hot because of entanglement across the horizon, a very special kind of entanglement, a very ordered state. And to study the entanglement entropy of this state, you need full quantum gravity, for instance, spin foams. But if you focus on small perturbations, low energy perturbations, then you can look at perturbations of the entanglement entropy, and you find a universal result that is stable, and you can trust in perturbative quantum field theory, and this is the Bekenstein-Hawking area law. And I'll conclude here. Thank you very much for the attention.
Okay, thank you for a very nice talk. Just one question, comment question. So I understand and I agree with the statement that the temperature is something you can derive in this from this pure state and then doing. But would you agree that this this has an input that has to do with the geometry of so. You start with the assumption that your pure state is the Minkowski vacuum, for example. And then you trace out of certain degrees of freedoms based on the geometry of the Rindler horizon that you want to. So saying that the temperature comes from entanglement is a bit like also like saying that it has to do with the background close to the horizon. Do you agree with that?
Yeah, I agree with that, but I think that the statement is quantum and inside the theory, the temperature is coming from entanglement. Entanglement depends on the state, so I'm saying for very special states, for the ones that describe flat space or for the ones that describe a black hole, then you have this property. I agree. Yeah.
Yeah. I guess it's continuation of this question and some discussion that Laurent had with Alex. I think the first part in which you did the semi-classical calculation or using effective field theory, in which you had a the Rindler horizon, and you did the effective field theory, including gravity, that is sort of clean, I understand that. But when you brought in spin networks, then I get confused, because now we are really trying to do it non-perturbatively, and yet one has to have this background, one has to have something which is, and then, you know, you also had on the top of the transparency something like Hartle-Hawking state. I didn't know what you meant by that, but I don't understand how we have Hartle-Hawking state in the spin network picture. And also, when you wrote down the Hamiltonian, you had a Bose generator, and there is some mixing between in the space-time Bose generator, which is what the killing vector was doing, and the Bose generators in the internal space, that is what is happening in the spin form thing. So I think that there are just many, many gaps between the sort of the first part of the talk or the middle part of the talk and the spin form. And I just wanted to have your perspective on that.
Mm-hmm. I agree there are many gaps. It's the part to make robust and to develop the second part in spin forms is the one we are mostly interested in. So about you have two questions about the first question, the Hartle-Hawking state. So getting this data is like solving spin forms. It's like computing the result of the path integral. And we are probably not going to do it analytically. So what we can look at is special cases or perturbative schemes or numerical results or semi-classical situations. So what I've done, my Hartle-Hawking state, is a state where instead of computing the path integral, the Euclidean path integral, for all times up to a given slice, I computed it just for one step, just one spin form, half spin form phase. This gives an amount of entanglement that is not large. It's just nearby nodes get entangled, but far away nodes are not entangled. When you go to next step and next step, you're going to get more entanglement. So this kind of state, it's a state that also people in condensed matter, where they have their two-dimensional system that is like on a lattice, and there's strong interaction between the elements. They are going to study, and they have used this as as an approximation scheme. They have an ansatz for the wave function. In one dimensions, they have these matrix product states. There are other ansatz that are better for two dimensions. And here, the natural one is these tensor product states that one can write explicitly. So what I'm saying is that there is one special state that has a natural interpretation of spin forms that I can write. Then there are two questions. One is, what is the physical interpretation of this state? Does it describe something like flat space as expectation values? And the second question is, what is its entanglement entropy? And I know how to answer the second question. It's a straightforward calculation. The entanglement entropy is finite, not like in quantum field theory. There's no cutoff to be put. The theory is finite. And it turns out also to have an interesting interpretation. About your second question about boosts, I keep thinking that this is something surprising. In the first part of the talk, I was speaking about the generator of boosts in quantum field theory. And this is boosts in a flat space. And it also speaks about the energy of your quantum field, because it's something that you can write in terms of the energy momentum tensor. It's the Rindler energy, this generator of boosts. On the other hand, in gravity, already at the classical level, it's something that one can look at. It's simply the boundary term, the corner term in the action. And this corner term is the one that generates the evolution at the bifurcation surface. And it is sort of surprising that written just in metric variables, this is the area, as Scarlett and Teitelbaum showed. And written in terms of spin form variables, it's also the area, but it's naturally written in terms of this internal generator of boosts. So I agree that it's surprising, but it's a simple classical fact. And probably the confusing aspect is the fact that I'm calling it boosts, while I should just call it boundary Hamiltonian.
But there's a gap, right? Namely that you said this state that you calculated, you have to still show that it has something to do with the Rindler way, something to do with the flat space, and some...
Yes.
Mike? Yeah. Your first derivation for small perturbations, basic assumption is that you have a Minkowski vacuum in the freely falling near horizon geometry. seems similar to derivation of Hawking radiation based on the microlocal spectral condition by, I don't actually want to ask how similar it is, by an Italian group, I think Moretti, Di Piaggi, those people, I don't know who exactly did it.
Yes, yes, it's very close to the analysis of Walter Moretti in axiomatic quantum field theory. It's an analysis, the thing that they look at is quantum fields at the temperature and also at the entropy of the quantum fields alone. What they don't have there is the gravitational back reaction.
One more question, quick question.
Regarding this connection to axiomatic quantum field theory, I was wondering there, this divergence of the entanglement entropy is traced back to the failure of this tensor product structure of the Hilbert spaces. So can you comment on this, how this...
Yes, yes, thank you for the question. It's a very good point. So the way I presented it is quantum field theory for me is defined with a cutoff, an ultraviolet cutoff. And I have a reason to think about it in this way because it's the way I do calculations and I have a motivation from quantum gravity. However, if you want to look at that, want to look at quantum field theory without thinking that you need a cutoff, as it's done in the axiomatic setting, then you have to ask again, can I make sense of the entropy or the entanglement entropy without ever introducing a cutoff? Clearly, saying that it's infinite is not making sense of it. So what they do is to study something very close, that is the relative entropy.